Alright, what is up folks? It is Sunday, so you know what that means. We're going to be taking a look at RISC-V. Today specifically, we're going to do a quick video on just memory and the Endianess of the RISC-V system, and then we'll take a look at a couple more instructions in another video. This video is going to be about memory. Again, always check the GitHub for updates. Got a little MD file in the reference section. Let's also check out this code in the code section, and let's get straight to it. Okay, first things first that you're going to notice is there are many RISC-V assemblers and runtime simulators. In this series, we're using RARS, which is by the third one. It's certainly not the best one. It's certainly not the most popular one, but it is the one that we're using. And these, each one has their own set of supported instructions. Again, RISC-V is completely open source. So the things that are supported, the things that are not supported, the instructions that are allowed, the instructions that are named, all of that is pretty dependent on the assembler and runtime simulator. So things generally are the same, but the available codes for eCall I'm noticing vary very widely. So we are using RARS in this series. And you got to keep that in mind when you're copying this code. Everything here should work in all of the assemblers and runtime simulators, but some of the codes may be different. So keep that in mind. All right, so just to hammer that point home, if you look at the Jupyter assembler and runtime simulator, you will see that there is a code 23, there's a code 22, code 21. There's a lot of codes in the 20s. But if you go to the third one's supported environment calls, you'll see that there are no codes in the 20s at all. So if you run an eCall with a code that doesn't exist, you're going to get an address out of range runtime exception. You'll see here that it's it's pointing to 17, which is 23, which is 16 plus 7. I'm not going to do the math, but whatever that is, it's in the 20s and it doesn't exist. So if you see that, you're using a code that probably doesn't exist, especially if it's in the A0 register, which is where the instructions should be stored. All right, so here we are with a little sample code that prints a string asking you to enter a 3-character string. It's going to allocate bytes for these 3 characters. It's going to read the 3 characters that you entered, store them in the specified spot, and then exit. It's not going to do any outputting after that. Probably should add some, but this is just a good way to see that the LI instruction with codes and addresses that fit into the space available can be replaced with the add I instruction. So if you got a location and a register, which together ends up being less than 32 bytes, you can just use the add I instruction. This code shows that. When we go ahead and assemble, you'll see that the LA instruction gets split up into the AUIPC and the add I, because we have to load a piece of something, which is going to be 32 bytes, because that's the memory width that we're dealing with. I'll explain that later. But you'll see that the LI instruction is just an add I instruction. It doesn't even split up. So we'll see that. And we'll also see the endianness of this system when we check the heap for the values that we have stored. So stay tuned for that. More stuff in depth coming. I know that was quick. We'll break it down. All right, so a quick recap of the sections that we should be paying attention to. We have the edit section here, which is just the code that we can edit in a typable view so that it's easy to work with. We have the execute tab here, which is going to show us the text segment. This is the text in this area here. It's going to have some sections that are important: the address of the line of code, the code itself, and the way that the code is being handled, and the actual source code right here. Then we have the data segment section. This is going to have all the data for the program that we're running. In this case, there's going to be 3 sections we want to pay attention to. The dot data section, these are the variables that get established initially in the data section with the data directive. In this case, we just have 1 string that is terminated with a null character. And if we hit the ASCII code, we can see that. And you'll notice that everything is backwards because of the endianness, which we'll get into later. Then there is the heap section. This is where the variables that are changing get saved. And you'll see, as when we run the code, the string that we enter will get saved to the heap. And the text section, this is just where the code is stored, the actual program is stored. We're not going to really view that much. We'll probably stick with the data section and the heap section here. Then here there's the registers. These will change as the program progresses, storing various integers or numbers as we need them. And usually those numbers correspond to something important. So that's just a quick overview of the RARS interface. All right, so let's step through the program. We have assembled the program. That's the first step. Whenever you make any changes or any edits, you want to assemble the program. Then we can step through with the play button that's got a little one on there, and that's running one step at a time. So the first instruction we're going to run is the LA A0 comma prompt, and this is going to load the prompt into the address A0. What's actually going to happen, as we can see in this basic section here, is that we're going to run the AUIPC command, and that's going to store this value in the front half of this register, and that's going to be followed by an add I command, which is going to store a zero. It's going to just pad the end of it with zeros, and we have to split it up like that because what's really happening is we have a 20 bit value, and we're going to form a 32-bit value from just the 20-bit value. In this particular case, we got lucky that we only actually needed, it looks like, however many bits this is, but less than 20, less than 32 for sure. But that's not always going to be the case. So there's some complicated, not really complicated, but with the 20-bit offset, we form a 32-bit offset, add that to the program counter, which is down here, and store that in the destination value, which is X10, which corresponds to the A0 register. You don't really need to know that. All I need to know is we're loading the address, and if you go to the data section, you can see that the 10010000 address is what's stored in the A0 register, which is the pointer to the full string. And now's a good time to talk about the endianness, because we notice that the string that we're looking at is enter a 3-character string, and what we see is you know, we don't see that. So what's going on? So generally there's two ways to store information in a given memory block. You can store it big endian style, which, you know, you can think of as the right way to do it, I think personally, but you know, it doesn't really matter at the end of the day. Big endian style means that the first piece of data is stored in the first byte of the memory block, the first portion of the memory block, I think would be more accurate here. So if it was a big endian system, the first piece of the data would be the capital E, and that would be stored in the first portion of the data block that we have here. Instead, it's not the case. It's the other way around. We have a little endian system in which the first byte of the piece of data is stored in the last byte of the memory block. So here, the E is stored at the end instead of at the beginning, which is just another way to do it. You tell the machine how to read it, and it will read the values appropriately. It doesn't really make a difference which system your processor is using, but you do need to know which system it's using to make sure that you are extracting data correctly. All right, let's continue stepping through. So we have set up the prompt. Now we have another instruction. This is code number 4. You will see instruction 4 corresponds to print string. Now I'm looking in the third one, RARS environments call section. I also have some of this information on my own personal GitHub in the part 3 MD. So we will now run print string, which should print the string that we loaded earlier. And there we go. So the next thing we are going to do is run the sberk command, and that's going to allocate some memory in the A0 block. Remember, instructions are stored in the A7 register, and return values are generally in the A0 or A1 register, which we can see in the RISC-V card that you can find on my GitHub as well. Function arguments and return values, and function arguments. So let's see what happens. We're here. We're going to first allocate 4 bytes, and we'll see that the A0 changed to just the number 4. And then we're going to run the instruction in the A7 register, which is 9, and that corresponds to SBURK, which is just going to allocate memory, and we shouldn't really see much happening. Moving right along, since we're already using the A0 register, we might as well use the A1 register, as those are the two registers available to store stuff. And in the A1 register, we're going to store the 4 bytes that we want to be located in memory, and we are then going to store the number 8 in the A7 register, and 8 corresponds to the read string command, so we expect to read a string of 4 bytes into memory, and all of our strings are terminated with the null character. So when we're reading a 4 byte string, each character is 1 byte, so we gotta enter 3 characters at the most to make sure we don't have any overflow. All right, so let's read our 4 bytes into memory at the address located at A0. That address is 10040000, and we can go to the heap, which is where that starts. So once we let this run after the ecall here, now we're going to put in the string qwe, and we're going to hit enter here. Except we don't have to, we're just gonna go ahead and see that it is now in this block of memory, EWQ, with the null terminating character here. Little Endian, so it stores backwards, so to speak, but it still gets read. It just gets read from the other side, so it's just really where do you start reading, you know? Backwards, forwards, a lot of words are kind of meaningless in the computer space. But that's this program. And then we have the exit code here. It's gonna go ahead and exit once we get to the ecall portion here. And there we go, finished running. So that's basically it. You get a little sense of how the instructions work. Generally, the li is replaced with the addi unless there's some length issue with the instruction, then you have to split it up. The la also gets split up, but in this case it didn't really have to because of the addresses that were chosen. The endianness, we see that visually each piece of data in its block looks backwards to us, or you have to read it. You know, maybe if you're Japanese, it looks 100% right. I'm not sure what other languages, maybe you're Arabic, or you know, you speak Arabic or Japanese. Little Endian's the way to go. That's the correct way to read it. Who's to say? So I hope you got some information from this. That's just a little bit on the memory structure that RISC-V is working with and how RISC-V handles putting things into the proper places so they can be retrieved later. Another video coming out today. Maybe 2 more videos coming out today. So stay tuned. I'm glad you're here. Have a great Sunday. Have a blessed day. Have a blessed week. Have a blessed life. I hope you enjoy yourself much more than I am enjoying myself. Peace.